संस्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः. My very dear devotees, till now you have been listening to a very interesting discourse on Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna's teachings, especially on the basis of the introductory verse on the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. Tava kathamritam tapta jivanam kavibhiriditam kalmashapaham. So we are going to hear, as is our tradition, something about Sri Ramakrishna's relevance to our modern age. Sri Ramakrishna's great biographer, Swami Shardananda, he wrote the most comprehensive biography of Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna and called it Ramakrishna the Great Master. That is the English translation of what he wrote in Bengali as Leela Prasanga, Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna's Leela Prasanga. So that was translated into English by one Holy Mother's disciple, Swami Jagadananda. It's called the Sri Ramakrishna, the Great Master. Swami Sharadananda was one of the chosen monastic disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. In the sense, Sri Ramakrishna talked about Swami Sharadananda as one of the disciples of Jesus Christ. In his previous birth, he was a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now he has come again with the another incarnation, that is myself, he used to tell. This Sharadananda was a very, very precocious, very, very intelligent student. He was educated in Calcutta University as a medical student. And he spent years after he became a sannyasin in the Ramakrishna mission and spent in tapasya. He spent several years in India, in the Himalayas and all the other tirthas of Himalaya. He also went to West for preaching Vedanta and taught for 2 years in USA, and it was very successful. He was very successful, but he was required in India more urgently. Therefore, Swami Vivekananda called him back. He was a very successful preacher there in America, but Swami Vivekananda wanted him for a bigger work in India. What is that bigger work? That was the general secretaryship of the Ramakrishna Mutton Mission. Swamiji founded. Swamiji founded in 1897 the Ramakrishna Mission. So he wanted a general secretary for that one. So he called Swami Sharadananda. He was hardly 31 years old at that time, 3 years younger than Swami Vivekananda. He came and took up this mantle of the general secretary. He was one of the prodigious readers. He was a master of both Eastern philosophy and Western philosophy, not only intellectually, but by experience. He writes the foreword to the Ramakrishna Leela Prasanga, the Great Master, "I have not written in this book anything which I have not myself experienced." And there, inside that book, you will read everything about Samadhi. Of Sri Ramakrishna Samadhi, Bhava Samadhi, the different Bhava Samadhis, his Nirvikalpa Samadhi, steps to Nirvikalpa Samadhi, everything about the highest achievement in spiritual life according to Vedanta, he refers there. And he says, "I have not written anything which I have not myself experienced." See the excellence of this writer. He traces, why I am telling all these things is, such an authority on the world history, especially world spiritual history, he traces the cause for Sri Ramakrishna's advent. Why was Sri Ramakrishna born? So he traces the reasons for his advent. He says, the West, being forced by nature, rather an inclement nature, to be body-minded, and therefore it was selfish. The Western people, almost the whole of West, call it Europe, call it America, it is all sort of, it has got a very inclement nature. Hardly they get 2 months of summer. When they say good day, good morning, they have some meaning, because only 2 months they get. 10 months of winter, rain, cloudy. So those 2 months they celebrate, saying good morning, good night, good sun. So such an inclement weather. Therefore, they are all body-minded, naturally. They are oppressed, so they have to every time protect their body and then somehow keep themselves warm, fight with the nature, even for existence. So, Swami Sharadananda writes, this inclement weather has made them more and more body consciousness, and they have to provide more and more for just maintenance. In India, if you have got one cloth or two cloths, you know, you can be comfortably and very elegantly move about. In the West, at least, you know, 5 clothes are required. You require 2 below, 2 above, and 1, 2 on the head, and something to cover your neck, and a necktie, and a sock, and a boot, and gloves if necessary. Without that, you cannot move. Just imagine, one man's need is so much. So, if the need is there, so you have to procure that one. That nature does not produce so abundantly all the things they require as we in India have got. India is a land, in that sense, a heaven. Everything that is required for our nation, we produce ourselves. One of the vice chancellors of Ratanjankar University in MP, he went to an international exhibition and came back and reported to us, Swami, in that international exhibition, each country has exhibited what are all its productions in the industrial and in the other natural science field. You know, all the countries have got something only in one field. Maybe they have got some natural resources. Some countries have got some minerals. Some countries have got some fruit production. And some countries have got cotton production. There have got 1 or 2 or 3. And all other things they have to import from other countries. India is the only country which produces everything it wants. We produce our own cloth, we produce our own electricity, we produce our own mineral, we produce our own everything. India is complete by itself. It does not depend upon anybody else. Such a bountiful country is this country. Therefore, our needs are very little. So, they say, in Bengal, they don't have to sow the, they don't have to work hard at all, because the soil is so good and Ganga is so kind. So every time Ganga goes into floods, brings new manure to their grounds. They simply throw the seeds and the seeds grow. They get 2 crops in a year. So that is why they always play flute and make music. Bengal is full of art and music. Because, you know, life is so easy. Because the nature is bountiful. So Swami Sharadananda traces this selfishness in the West is forced upon them by the inclement nature. And the selflessness in India is forced by our bountiful nature. We don't require anything to protect our body. So only 2 pieces of cloth are enough to keep ourselves quite decent. And we can divert our mind to other higher fields. That is how we became philosophical. We started thinking about these deeper things in life. God, soul, the inexorable moral laws, the causes of the bondage of man, causes of the freedom of man, all these philosophical issues, we wanted to realize the truth. So we went into deep philosophical mood because of this plentiful nature. But those people, their condition was to protect their body itself, they have to struggle hard. Whatever they may struggle, they cannot get produce everything in their country. Therefore, they have to get it from the other countries. Why will other countries give to you? Therefore, they have to invade the other country. To invade the other country, they want all weapons, all science. So they invented science, and science was there for good purposes. But most of the science was used for wars. So they used everything for war, subjugate the other countries. Africa was subjugated, South America was subjugated, India was subjugated, Burma, Ceylon, Japan, China, all were subjugated, colonized, just because of their selfishness. So naturally, the Western civilization is built upon this idea that you must fight and you must live a good life at whatever rate. It doesn't matter if you invade the others. You have to invade, snatch away everything that they have produced. So a sort of an atheistic outlook. And in this fight, they were not allowed free hand by the church, because the science could not progress. Whatever science was invented newly or discovered newly, the church could not accept, because the church said, you see, the Bible says such and such a thing, which is contrary to your science. And there was always a struggle between, and a quarrel between the science and the church. So in the finally, the church, the scientific people threw away the church and the church fathers. They said, we don't want church, we don't want church father, we don't want God, we don't want to believe in soul. And so the whole nation became more or less materialistic and atheistic. And unfortunately for India, they came and conquered India. As I have already said, India, China, Japan, Burma, Ceylon, South Africa, South America, Africa and South America, all were colonized. So whenever you go under a colony, the colonial people, they have their own ways. They imposed their culture upon us. Their culture was exactly contrary to what Indian culture was. So Swami Sharadananji writes, so the Western people united to exploit other countries. This is what they call patriotism. In Western countries, patriotism is not a very good thing. If somebody is very patriotic and very strong nation, all other nations around, they are afraid of him, because he will come and invade us. That is what has happened in the Western history. If some country becomes strong than the others, it is sure he will go and invade others and exploit them. So that is why if some country becomes strong, all the others, you know, they are afraid. Oh, he has become strong. So because their idea is to exploit others. So the name of patriotism, it is all self-interest. They used to combine, and as a group, they would attack, they would colonize, they would exploit. So this sort of patriotism developed there. And then this patriotic, with that feeling, they said, we will expand our kingdom. We want to have our colonies. So they came and then occupied several places. With the same thing, with this idea, atheists, and they became atheists because the church would not allow them to freehand, to just go and colonize or exploit others. They would ask them to believe in God, believe in soul, believe in other world, believe in heaven, believe in sin, believe in merit. So they said, no, if we believe all these things, we cannot exploit others. We cannot live a comfortable and very opulent life here. So they rejected God, rejected soul, rejected moral values as the basis of human peace and progress. So they conquered by fraud and force India, South America, Africa, China, Japan, as I already told. These countries also started because they were colonized. They were weak. We were philosophical, it is all right. We were enjoying our philosophy, our simple life, our inner peace and inner joy, our bhakti and our jnana, we were enjoying. But when people came from outside with weapons, most modern, with cannons, which would blow up all your forts, we had no reply for that. Similarly, were all the much worse than us were the other countries. So when these people went and invaded, we had no reply. So we were all easily conquered. And the conquering race was so atrocious, they tried to impose all their culture, Western culture, upon our country. And our people also started thinking, oh, Western people are superior to us. Their philosophy of life is superior to us. Their values of life is different But it is superior to us because we have become slaves. They have become the rulers. So now we are the governed and they are the governors. Therefore, we should follow them. We lost our faith in our own God, our soul, our culture, which is millennia old. So we lost our self-confidence. When once you lose self-confidence, you start going down, tumbling down. So that is how we started imitating the West. India having a salubrious nature of plenty, always produced spiritual geniuses, in contrast to the West. As I have already told, India had a salubrious nature. We had very little to struggle for physical existence. Therefore, we gave our mind to higher thoughts and we produced such a spiritual genius whom we called as rishis. And among the rishis, there were the Adhikarika Purushas, the Ishwara Kotis and the Avataras. So many were philosophical giants, the religious giants, spiritual giants were produced. And they would tell us that we have seen God, we have seen soul. We can tell you what will happen after 10,000 years. We can happen what will happen to you if you do this one after 15 years. Or why this is happening, because you did it 50 years back. We can tell you. They knew all the past, the present and the future. They had no demarcation. They lived in an eternity. Such spiritual geniuses we produced. Therefore, we never doubted God. We never doubted souls. We never doubted the inexorable moral law. If you do good, you will certainly get good. If you do bad, you will get bad in return. So we believed in it 100% because we had seen hundreds of saints, hundreds of years, and dozens of avataras. The maximum avataras are from India. So these avataras are countless. In Bhagavata, it is said 24. Sri Ramakrishna said, in another place in Bhagavata, it is said, Asankhyaya avatara. There are numberless. So numberless avataras have been produced in this country. So they have demonstrated that God is true, soul is true, the moral law is true, the causes of bondage are true, and the way to get out of the bondage is also true. All these things are true. So we had a tremendous faith in this. So we put all our energy, individually and as a nation. We were a spiritual nation. Our goal was to see God, to see the soul, to know the inexorable moral law. So therefore live a life of high morality from which, you know, we can produce the good to the whole world. Never hate anybody. Do always good. Do all. Love everybody. Serve others. Sacrifice for others. This was our motto. The whole nation was a spiritual nation. We lost faith in our own national blood. We were living like this for thousands of years. That is how we could produce so many avataras. The last greatest one, an internationally recognized one, is Buddha. Buddha was such a great an avatar. So he is almost 2/3 of the world became Buddhist when he preached his gospel. He preached only nothing but Vedas only, Vedanta only. He preached it to everybody in the simplest language. So we lost faith in such a religion, which was our backbone. So India's backbone was lost. When he started imitating the West, thinking whatever they have is the superior one. So our gods are untrue, our soul is untrue, and the belief in rebirth, belief in the other world, it is all simply a sort of a imagination. All sorts of things we started believing and became weak because our backbone was lost. That was the condition. If backbone is lost, man himself is lost. We will be like only fishes. We cannot even stand. Man is able to stand because of his backbone. So we lost our backbone. India's backbone was lost. And to restore this backbone, the faith in the eternal religion by which we had lived, and we have established greatest spiritual empire in the world, Sri Ramakrishna was necessary to take birth. And he took birth. And he came and proved to the world that if science is true, the physical science is true, spiritual science also is true. If this, the investigation and experimentation is the path of science, the physical science, in the field of physical science, even in spiritual field also, you have to experiment, you have to verify. You can have realization. You can demonstrate the truth. So Sri Ramakrishna was the person who did it like a spiritual scientist. He experimented with religion and he just came to the conclusion that God is true, soul is true, the eternal law of moral is true, the eternal laws that govern the whole creation is true. Why is it true? I have experienced it. Oh, you must have experienced it. It might be only a sort of a hallucination. You might have seen a dream, or you must have seen a ghost, something like as you see a ghost. So it must be your own hallucination. No, I can make you also see. And I have got a method for it. Not only you, anybody who follows this method, you can see the truth that I have seen. What more do you want for a scientific way of representing religion? It was Sri Ramakrishna who made religion into a science of spirituality. Swami Vivekananda told this again and again. It was Sri Ramakrishna who said, if science is true, because it can show the thing that it discovers through a method, and it is a universal method, anybody can follow it and arrive at the truth. Sri Ramakrishna also said the same thing. God is true. I have got a universal method. Anybody can experiment it. Anybody can realize truth. That is God. So he made the spirituality as a science. So science and spirituality, they become equal. Nobody can deny the spirituality. We have never denied science. Science was trying to deny the Western religion because they did not have this scientific approach to religion. Indians Vedanta, Sri Ramakrishna's Sanatana Dharma, it is a scientific religion. So you can demonstrate God, you can show God to others, tell them the path of the four yogas. Swami Vivekananda put it in the form of four yogas, though he did not mean that there are only four yogas. Swamiji himself said, in a general way there are four yogas, but different combinations of these yogas can produce millions and millions of yogas. Each man must have his own yoga. And through the yoga, he will concentrate his mind, he will purify his mind, he concentrating on the object of God, he realizes God, he sees God, he experiences God. So God is as true as the primordial energy, the physics says today, from which the whole universe has come. Science says from primordial energy, whole universe has come through a big bang. Sri Ramakrishna says, by God's will, he himself has become the whole universe. Same thing, but only difference is, here, according to science, everything is material. According to Sri Ramakrishna, it is all spiritual. Everything is living, throbbing. Everything is living. Even this chair table has got consciousness. It can speak if you have got the ears to hear it. Yes, Jagadish Chandra Bose had eyes to see or ears to hear the plants talking, plant suffering. You inject something into the plant, it suffers. He could show by experiments that plants, you see, if you put some poisonous matter into it, it just suffers just as we suffer by taking some poisonous matter into us. So you can demonstrate everywhere there is God. The whole thing is God. And Sri Ramakrishna put it in a straightest way. I see everything is as God only. I see Latu sitting there, but I see God alone is sitting in that form. Everything is God. I went to pluck the fruits or flowers from the tree. I found the whole tree was God. So what to pluck flowers? I gave up plucking flowers. Everywhere he saw God alone. So it is to prove this religion as true as the science, and put back this ancient nation of India into its Vedic track, Sanatana Dharma track, Sri Ramakrishna was born. So his birth, as all of you know, so 1836, in a village nobody ever had known, even Bengal did not know about Kamarpukur when the time when Sri Ramakrishna was born. When we went in 1962, first time when I went, I myself had to cross two rivers and then leave the bus here, go by a boat and take another bus and go to the another river. There leave the bus behind, get into a boat, cross there, take another bus to go to this Kamarpukur village of 100 miles distance from Calcutta. This was the village where Sri Ramakrishna was born. Today in the whole world knows what Kamarpukur is. That is the glory of Sri Ramakrishna. So Sri Ramakrishna came to preach this religion which is universal, that you can see, you can experiment and know for yourself whether it is true or not. So that gave the stability not only to Hindu religion, to all the other religions also. Now almost all the other religions are taking resort to Sri Ramakrishna's teaching. They quote Sri Ramakrishna. He has seen Sri Ramakrishna. Yes, Sri Ramakrishna has seen God. You cannot deny his life. Every incident in his life is recorded. And he says, I have seen. There is nothing to deny about it. So the science is very silent now. So they are on the back seat now. So they are just, they're talking violently against the religion is getting reduced day by day. So Sri Ramakrishna gave us this great gospel that the whole universe is spiritual. Man is divine. Everything is divine. Only the manifestation of the divinity is different from man to man. The goal of human life is to manifest this divinity that is already inside us. We are all children of God, and God is infinite in life. He is infinite in knowledge. He is infinite in love and joy. We have got also infinite joy in us. By nature, we are infinitely joyful beings. We are infinitely powerful and knowledgeable beings. We are infinitely living. We are immortal beings. We never die as souls. This body may die. Body is only covering for the soul. Sri Ramakrishna taught this one through experience, demonstrated this one, and this message is capturing the whole world now. Everywhere, people want demonstration of religion. People want experience in religion. So in the West, yoga is becoming a rage. In America itself, they say 10 crores of people are practicing yoga in the factory, in the factories, in the houses, in the theaters, in hotels. Everywhere there is yoga there. Yoga means they want to have some experience, not simply hearing dogmas. So someone gives a lecture and then you hear and then he asks you to believe it. You should believe it. If you do not, punishment is there for you. Either here or in the heaven somewhere. So all these things, you know, they have rejected. Now they want to experience religion. That is possible only through yoga, only through the Vedantic ideal of you can realize God by living a particular disciplined life, having values of life. So this great truth was preached by Sri Ramakrishna and imparted to many of his disciples. Prominent of them was Swami Vivekananda, as you all know. And then he spread this one all over the world. So what did Sri Ramakrishna preach? He said, have the goal of life as realization of God. That is, realization of God as your own part and parcel of your soul. We are all part and parcel of God. Because God alone is there. All the religions in the world, they say that God created this creation out of himself. The whole creation is God himself. We are all part and parcel of God. That means God is infinite life. God is infinite knowledge. God is infinite bliss. So we being his children, being his part, we are also exactly like that. We have also infinite life in us. We don't die as souls. As souls, we never die. And similarly, we have got infinite knowledge. There is no limit to the knowledge of man. We see in this world itself, there are people who are having 3 doctorate degrees and 4th doctorate degrees, they are trying. There is no end to the knowledge because knowledge has no weight. Oh, I have taken 3 PhDs, my head is very heavy. So there is no heaviness. You can have 15 degrees, nothing will be heavy to you. Knowledge is the lightest thing. You see and you know, that is the Chaitanya. The consciousness is the power which sees and says, I know. I see you and I say, I know. Have I got anything inside my head after seeing you and knowing this? I didn't take anything into my head. I saw and I got the knowledge. Seeing is knowing. So anything you can see, everything you know. Therefore, the infinite scope for infinite knowledge. So every one of us have this power in us and infinite joy in us. Then this should be our goal. Actually, what we want in our life also is we want to live long. How long? Nobody can answer this one. 100 years will not be enough for you. There are people, so many people who live in 100 years, they are gone beyond it. They have also not thinking of leaving the world by themselves. When they are taken away from the fold, they will go. They don't want to leave. We will not be satisfied with 100 years or 200, 300 years. So, we always want infinite life. Similarly, knowledge, as I said, people have taken 4 doctorates, they want the 5th doctorate. They want to know more. It was Newton who said, such a brilliant scientist, after whom only after 400 years we could get Albert Einstein. Such a great Newton, he said, when he was asked, oh, you are such a great man, you know so much. He said, no, I am only picking pebbles on the ocean of knowledge, he said. I am only picking pebbles on the ocean of knowledge. That was Newton. He knew that so much is to be known. And our knowledge is so little. And we can know all that. So the infinite knowledge we are capable of. And infinite love we are capable of. We see people, how much. There are people who run orphanages with 100 people, with 200 people. 1,000 people, one single Swami is running. I saw in Tumkur, in one part of Karnataka. That Swami is 110 years old now. Even now he climbs the steps, 20 steps, he comes out and sits in the meeting. And then I was in a meeting with him. And then we all spoke. He remembers everything. His memory is very good. When he spoke, he referred to all our speeches and then gave his decision about his opinion about all our speeches. One man, he says, I started by having a few orphan children when I started as a monk of the Veerashaiva order. They are all devotees of Shiva. And as a Veerashaiva sannyasi, he took a few boys and he would beg. And whatever he would get through begging, he would feed these children, he would feed himself also. He started with a few children. Today, 1,000 boys are there in his hostel, all free. All free. He gives them from class A to perhaps doctorate they are studying. He is in the hostel. He has got his own school. He has got his own engineering colleges. He has got medical colleges. Everything. So much love. Out of his love, he can love 1,000 people. And yet, you know, he himself personally goes and supervises and sees the children. They are being fed well. And the joy on his face you can see. There is no limit to the love of man. Infinite love. So all this is possible when we know that we are the souls. We are the children of God. Sri Ramakrishna taught us how to know ourselves as souls. How to know that we are children of God. Can all people attain this one? Somebody asked Sri Ramakrishna. It is all right that if we know that we are the soul, we get all these infinite graces, that we have got immortal life, that we have got infinite knowledge and power, we have got infinite bliss and joy. But can all attain this one? He said, yes. Householders can attain to this one. Monks can attain to this one. Men can attain to this one. Women can attain to this one. And people of all ages, young or old, can attain to this one. Irrespective of religion, people can attain to this one. It is a universal path by following which you can attain to the state of godliness. We ourselves can become like gods. Then, what is the way? Is it a very difficult way then? There may be a path, but all of us cannot get it. We have got big hospital, private hospitals are there. Best, they advertise. Oh, you come here, all diseases will be treated. Immediate attention will be given. Best nurses are here. Big hoardings are there. How many of us can afford to go there? What about your pocket? Your pocket determines where you go and where you cannot go. So is it a very difficult path? The path may be there, but is it available to everyone? Sri Ramakrishna said it is open to everyone. You don't have to pay anything. To realize God, you don't have to pay 1 paisa capitation fee. You don't have to go to any university. You don't have to stand in the queue to get the application from any college. You can attain to the highest knowledge by yearning for God. Have you got a desire to realize God? Develop the desire. I want God, I want God. Just as a child would need its mother. I want mother, I want mother. Sri Ramakrishna is so fond of this example of mother and child. You can cajole a child, he says. You can cajole a child with sweets, with dolls for some time. He will eat the sweets and forget the mother for a few minutes. As soon as the sweets are over, Amma, he started crying. Arre, this fellow has started crying, give him some dolls. So he plays for a few minutes with the doll. Afterwards, he throws the Amma. That Amma he can never forget. He will just yearn for. Can you develop this yearning for God? Do you feel that need for God? That is the only one qualification that is required. Real, sincere love for God. So if you have got this one, you can certainly realize God. So many of our saints and seers, they were illiterate, uneducated. Sri Ramakrishna himself in that respect is an illiterate only. Holy Mother was also illiterate. Lato Maharaj was illiterate. And the scores and scores of Maharashtra saints and seers, we have got numberless. The Janabai is there, Sakubai is there. So all these people, illiterate, they have realized God through yearning, through love for God. I want God, I want God, I don't want anything else. Viveka Vairagya on one side, I don't want this world, I want God. So you throw away the pieces of dolls and cry, mother will come. Sri Ramakrishna's example. Throwing away the pieces of dolls is Vairagya. I don't want this worldly enjoyment. Enough of it I have had. It is a rigmarole. Going on eating idli sambar all your life, you're never getting tired of it. It is a shameful thing. Only going on eat, at least eat something different every day. You could have tasted some millions and millions of tasteful things. That also you don't do. Going on rigmarole. In this rigmarole, we get into this. And we say, we cannot give it up. So deep is our samskara. So vairagya is required. When vairagya develops, I don't want this world. If you say already, you have developed love for God. The more you develop love for God, the detachment to the world automatically comes. Sri Ramakrishna, this is the only qualification that is required. He says, this comes through everyone. We can develop it also. We have got our own duties in the world. Should you all become monks and nuns? Sri Ramakrishna said, no, nothing of that sort. Sri Ramakrishna is Sanatana Dharma. He didn't want everybody to become monk because Sanatana Dharma says people can attain to the highest in the very state of life they are in. People in different ashramas, brahmacharis are there, grihasthas are there, vanaprasthas are there, sannyasis are there. In that ashrama itself, they can attain to the highest. They can progress and they can attain to the highest. Sve sve karmanya virataha samsiddhim labate naraha. Sve sve karmani. Your own karma, your own duties. Do your duties well with detachment and with love of God. This is the only thing we have to do. Do your duty, but be detached from the duty and offer the fruits of that karma to God and love God. Love the world, love more the God. When Brutus was killed, then he was asked, so I loved my country more than I loved Brutus, he said. So So not that I did not love Brutus, I loved my country more. So you love God more, love the world, but love God more. This is Sri Ramakrishna's instruction. Do all that is required for your worldly life. Love your wife, love your father, love your children, love your grandchildren. But have more love for God. In the sense, all this wife, children, etc., sometime I have to leave and go. If I don't leave, they may leave and go also. Both things may happen. So, but with God, He will never leave you. So He is eternally yours. Think about this one. Hold on to God. So if you do this one, this yearning itself will give you the highest knowledge. Then, if this is the simplest religion, then why are all the religious leaders quarreling with one another? Sri Ramakrishna said, because no religious preacher who preaches hatred towards others has realized anything about it. They are only theoreticians. So they just think that my religion is the best religion. If you just think that yours is the best, it will not become the best. You must go and compare it with others. Others also must say that yours is the best religion. Most of the preachings of the different religious people who advocate hatred, it is all based on only theory. So Sri Ramakrishna said, don't preach before realization. If you don't have realization, you have no authority to preach religion. Or somebody preaches without authority to religion, don't believe him. Common man, we must have this common sense. If somebody says, no, that religion is wrong, my religion is true, then we must go and ask him, have you realized your religion? What is the your religion's goal of your religion? Have you realized it? Immediately you know he has not realized. He has taken some theory from somebody and he is preaching it. If somebody preaches from theory, don't believe him. Then you will be at peace, you will allow others also at peace. So Sri Ramakrishna said, they are all, each one has got his own partial experience of God. So if a man has a partial experience, he will say this is the whole. A part cannot become the whole. God is everything. God is Krishna, God is Shiva, God is Jesus, God is Muhammad, God is Allah, God is Zoroaster, God is Buddha, God is everything. He is an infinite being. He has got millions of names, but the substance is one. If you realize this one, we don't quarrel about the name of religion. We don't want to just create problem in the names of religion. Then proper spiritual teacher is required to inspire us in this spiritual life. We are lions, but we are thinking we are sheep. The great famous Vedantic story. We are not sheep, we are lions, but somehow or other we are hypnotized to think we are sheep. Only require another lion to come and say, hey, you are only lion, you are a cub, you are not a sheep. When once we look into the water, standing by the side of our guru, he shows my face and your face is the same. I have realized God, you are also part and parcel of God. Immediately the knowledge comes to us. So Sri Ramakrishna has established a galaxy of gurus from his time. He has produced how many gurus? The 16 direct disciples and perhaps hundreds of householder disciples. Each one was a guru by himself. And from their line, millions and millions of people are getting direct knowledge of the spiritual life. If you follow the simple method of Sri Ramakrishna, then we realize our lionness. Now we are thinking we are sheep. Only these real gurus come and say, no, you are not the ordinary human being. You may think you are an ordinary being. You may think you know you are a sinner. You may think you are weak. All is wrong. You are everything. You have got all the powers in you. Only yearn for God. Try to practice detachment to the world. Live in the world with the detachment. And then call on God. You will realize God. That is how Sri Ramakrishna made the religion so simple. Sri Ramakrishna is the supreme guru. He gives us realization. The Swamiji's words. Swami Vivekananda was speaking to another direct disciple. They were discussing about Sri Ramakrishna's greatness. Swami Vivekananda tells his brother disciple, Sri Ramakrishna is a supreme guru. He can give you realization. He can give you mukti. He can give you bhakti. He is the way for that one. Follow Sri Ramakrishna. You will get bhakti, you will get mukti. Bhakti is staying in the world and loving God. And afterwards, leave the world and go and completely live with one with God. So this is mukti and bhakti. All will come to you by going to Sri Ramakrishna and his simple religion. Sri Ramakrishna himself says, if you go to the real guru, like an avatara purusha, it is something like dispelling 1,000 years darkness. 1,000 years darkness is there. Do you require 1,000 year light for that one? You require only one moment of light. A light flashes and the 1,000 years of darkness disappears. That is the avatara purusha, Sri Ramakrishna's example. Real guru, when once he says, no, you will realize God, you practice. This one instruction enough, it will awaken you. You may not immediately at that moment realize God, but you can never give up that quest of God. This is the power of the guru. When real power guru comes to you, when he says, you follow the spiritual path, you are certainly going to realize. You may not realize at that very moment, but certainly you cannot give up that ideal of realization of God. You will pursue it. One day you are going to arrive at it. Prayatnadyatamanastu yogi samshuddha kalbishaha aneka janma samsiddha tatoyati parangatim. Bhagavad Gita. He says, if once this idea of realization comes, men try again and again to reach that. If they are not able to achieve it one birth, they will come into the next birth and pursue the same thing until they attain the highest. Yogi samshuddha kalbisha kilbisha aneka janma samsiddha. But many, many births is nothing. For this infinite Atman, 4 or 5 births is nothing. But that goal will be fixed if we take the instruction from the real guru. And real guru Sri Ramakrishna himself has created. And whatever guru comes to you, it is Sri Ramakrishna himself who comes to you in that form. So Sri Ramakrishna always used to say, come, come. Whenever any people used to go to him, he would speak a few words to them. Come again, he used to say. That is the magic charm he would put on the people. If he says come again, not come only tomorrow morning, not day after tomorrow morning, 2 times. All your life you must be coming. If you don't achieve the goal, next Janma also you have to go to him again. Until you realize he will not leave you. That is Sri Ramakrishna. We are all very lucky to think about him on the sacred day, about his simple teachings and about his great heart, that every one of us must realize our own divinity and attain to infinite life, infinite knowledge, infinite bliss. May Sri Ramakrishna bless us all. Jai Sri Ramakrishna. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.